Okay, so from today and for the next 3 weeks, we gonna discuss about the pointers in C pointer. Pointer is you know, one of the most unique and important feature of the C program language. Okay, so the pointers. Pointer is the most important and unique feature of C. And this pointer is actually the reason that we are using and learning C. So there is, you know, a lot of, you know, C programming language, you know, like Java or Python or Ruby or Visual Basic or blah 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 blah, many others. However, the reason that we are, you know, the choosing C as a, you know, the basic program language, especially, you know, for the engineering school of the, you know, the Korean university, the reason is because of the pointer, basically because of the pointer. Pointer actually making C is very powerful and very close to the machine-like language. So you might remember that, you know, this figure. This figure, you know, I showed this figure to the very first class of this C programming class. So there's a lot of languages. But some language is more close to the human side. So the more close to human, and which means, you know, it is more closer to the, you know, human language, natural language, human language. However, some language is, you know, very close to the machines, so the only machine understand. So for example, the machine code, like, you know, the 010101, so the human never human can interpret that code, but it is very difficult. It's very difficult. But machine is very easy to understand that is 0101 type of, you know, the machine code. And the assembly language. Assembly language is, you know, just a mapping of the 0101 to the certain alphabets, certain words. So that's, you know, the assembly language. So it's much, it is, you know, not that much, but a bit better than machine code for human to you know, look at it, at least, you know, look at it and understand it. However, this is, you know, the assembly and the machine code. Those are, you know, very close to machine, so they are, you know, the machine dependent. That means if you build a code for your, you know, this PC, but that code cannot be used for the, you know, let's say the Mac or, you know, the Android phones, we cannot use it. Because, you know, those assembly and machine code, they are all very dependent on machine. So even though, even you are making program for this computer, but even though it's in the same IBM or, you know, the Intel machine, so it may not work. Because, you know, if you write a program with the assembly or machine code, that's really dependent on machine. But instead, this is the machine dependent language. They are hardly used for the program. So if you actually make some hardware, then this, you know, assembly or machine code is, you know, very necessary because that's a hardware dependent. But if you only consider the software part, those assembly type of stuff is very rarely used. So instead, in order to, you know, the design and the implement some, you know, high level algorithm only for the, you know, computation, we like to use, you know, the human-like language, which is very machine dependent. That means if you want to, you know, write a program, let's say Java or Perl, that code can be executed for any other machines. Okay? So that's the machine dependent one. So once you have a program code, that can be run for any other machines. that's a machine learning. That's the machine independent one. Among those machine independent one, like the MATLAB or the MS Excel, so Microsoft Excel, those are very close to human side. Because in the programming language, we call those the function-based language. That means they actually implement some functions. For example, if you think about which one is more familiar to your Excel? So let's think of the Excel. In the Excel, so you may know the Excel has some the programming part. So it has some programming part. For example, if you want to take the average of the 100 numbers, the easiest way is using Excel, right? Just copy and paste the 100 number to Excel, then just using some functions like average or sum, you can easily calculate the average. So the Excel or MATLAB, they are all implemented some useful functions. Either function based. So that's actually much close to what human think. However, some more general language like C or Java, or in the C++ or Perl, those are based on procedure based. So they actually implement some steps, some procedures that is consist of the very basic functions like the read and write and save and some basic arithmetic, the add or the multiply, those ones. For example, if you want to implement taking average of 100 values, basically you need to run, let's say the for loop, then make another summation for 100 times, then divide by once. So that's actually it's the way to implement the average in C. So among these the human-like language and the machine-independent language, the reason that we are using C is most close to the closest one to the machine side. So basically, if the language is close to human, it's easy to use and easy to learn and easy to use. However, the functionality of the language or the space that this language can do is sort of limited. It's limited. However, it is close to the machine side. It can actually use all the function of the machines if the language is close to the machine side. If it's close to the human side, so it's easy to use. However, it actually only uses some limited part of the machines, computers. But if it's close to the machine, it can actually utilize all of the functionality or all the functions of the all the ability of the machines. But this ability is definitely it's difficult to use. It's difficult to use and difficult to learn. So basically, the reason that we are using C is among the machine independent one, it is the most closest one to the machine side. That's why we are learning C. Then what actually made the C is closest to the machine side? What actually makes the C is close to machine? That is the pointer actually. Pointer makes C is the very close to the machines. Okay, so let's a little bit think about what is really happening in a C program. Let's think about the simple C program. This simple C program is void main function. Then it declares two variables A and B. Then we assign A to 3. Then we also assign A to the B. Then B's value is 3 and A's value is 3. So this is, you know, the very simple, you know, the SQL. There's nothing. So we just, you know, the declare variable, then we assign values, and that's it. But then we know, so the, by reading this, you know, C program, we know, okay, A value is 3 and B value is also 3. We can understand it. However, how this machine, actually computer, understand, you know, this one? So actually, let's see, you know, the, how this, you know, the computer understand, you know, this one. Basically, even though we use main or A, B, these are the variable names. Basically, the machine never understand, you know, the basic variable name. They don't care what's the variable name. Variable names are only for humans. Only for human. So that's why, you know, the, any variable names you can use. I'm already saying that, you know, the make the variable names more readable, more meaningfully. Instead of A, so if you're using, you know, the last, you know, the number of apples, that's more, you know, that's actually better name because that's more meaningful. Okay, so the, let's think about it, whatever. The first, if we declare the A and B, this statement means, okay, we're gonna use two integer variables. The machine, think about the computer. Computer has, you know, two compartments, two parts, two major, you know, components. The one is the CPU, that is, you know, the, that actually doing some operations. It's like if you want to, you know, to make additions, so if you want to, you know, to add two numbers, that is actually done in CPU. And the machine also has memory. Memory is, you know, the storage part. So if you want to add 3 and 5, you need to store this 3 and 5 in somewhere in the machine. That storage is a memory. So the machine, so the base fundamentally has two important parts, two essential parts, CPU and the memory. CPU is doing, you know, the real arithmetic, and memory store data, right? So you will understand because you already know, you know, what's the computers, right? So if you have, you know, the faster computer, that means you're going to have a better CPU, right? So if you have, you know, the, you may know, you know, the i7 is, so the, when you buy a machine, so there's, you know, several options, whether you want to use, you know, the i7 machine or i5 machine, i3 machines, you know. But you also know, you know, the i7 machine is much expensive than i3 machine because it is faster. If you ask to you, to the dealers, to the, you know, the high market dealers, you know, they're going to say i7 is expensive because it's faster. That means it has a better CPU. But also, your computer also has, you know, the memory, like, you know, the 4 GB memory or 8 GB memory or 2 GB memory. And that memory means how much you can store the data. Okay? So the computer has a two part. Definitely you also have, the hard disk, but that's, you know, the another storage. But those hard disk is not, basically it's not the essential part actually. So essential part is CPU and the memory. Okay, so let's think about, you know, the, okay, one. So the, but so the, for the, if you state, see the, you know, the one state, first statement, that means we're gonna use, you know, two variables for integers. That means this CPU actually orders to the memory, okay, I'm gonna use two integer variables. So please prepare space or rooms for two integers in the memory. Actually, this one orders to the memory. Okay? Please reserve two rooms for A and B. A and B. But they don't know A and B. But they don't know A and B. Just to make the two memories. To space for memories. Then in the memory, memory actually assigned two space or two rooms in the memory, then return their address. So here is the important part, is the address of the memory. Here, address of the memory. So that means, actually, when you say you the memory is, you know, the very big room. You can think of it as, you know, the big hotels. Big hotels. Then, if you, okay, so when you say, you know, okay, it's a 2 GB memory, that means, very, you know, the naively thinking, there is 2 GB. 2 GB means 2 billion. Am I right? Yes, 2 billion. 2 billion rooms in this hotel. So room, there's a room number. Room 1, room 2, and room 2 billion. There's 2 billion rooms in this, you know, the memory hotel. So when this, you know, the CPU says, okay, please prepare space for 2 integers in the memory, then this memory actually assigned 2 rooms for this use. Then this memory reserve 2 rooms, room 1 and 2. Room 1 and 2. Then room 1 is assigned to variable A, and room 2 is assigned to variable B. Then I return, it says, okay, so the, I reserve 2 rooms, and their memory address is 1 and 2. Memory address is the room number, right? So basically, so even though people use, you know, the human use A and B to represent this variable, the machine never understand, you know, the never use this variable names. They only use this memory address or room number. So they only use this room number 1 and room number 2. Okay? Now this CPU knows, okay, A, so room number 1 is assigned for A, and room number 2 is assigned to B. Then, by looking at this second statement, statement 2, A is equal to 3. So the human interpret that, okay, put 3 to the, you know, the variable A. However, in actually in machine actually say, okay, please store 3, that value 3 in the room number 1. That's actually what they say when they interpret A is equal to 3, because room number 1 is assigned to the variable A. So by this statement, they actually, you know, the assign value 3 to the room number 1 here. Okay? And similarly, if you know the statement 3 B equal to A, that means please copy value of 1, room number 1, value of the room 1 to the value of room 2. That's actually the B equal to A means. So in the room number 1, the value 3 is already stored, then copy this value to the room 2. That's actually what this third statement means. Okay? So basically, in the actual C program, everything is based on the memory address. Memory address. So if I summarize, when you assign, you know, the, when you, you know, declare a variable, that actually, you know, the reserve some space in the memory, and that space is represented by memory address or room number, unique room number. All right. So then let's see, you know, what's the pointer variables in C. Okay, a pointer or a pointer variable is a C variable that contains the memory address. So this is another data type. So the data type is either the integer data type, float data type, or we can define new data type using structure. So here I am introducing new data type that is pointer data type. basically pointer data type is called the memory address. Memory address. Okay. Pointer variable can be declared using asterisk mark or the disallowed star marks for any data type. So for example, if we use int asterisk pa, that means pa is a pointer variable of the integer variables. Pointer of integer variables. Because we declare int star. Okay, so let me get back. So the similarly, float asterisk pb is memory address for the floating variables. Similarly, character asterisk pc, then pc is memory address of a character variable. Similarly, struct data asterisk pd is a pointer of struct data type of a variable. So basically, so int is a, you know, data type, okay? Int is a data type of the integer, but int asterisk, int star, this is the data type of integer variable, pointer of the integer variable. Okay, int is a data type of integer values. Int star is a data type of pointer of integer int variable. Pointer of int variable that is declared in this type. Okay, so the int star itself is something similar to int because it represents a data type in C. Okay, so the memory address, okay, so the similarly, so for example, similarly, struct data, this is the data type of the user defined data type, right? And struct data star, this is a data type of pointer of struct data variable. So if you put star, this become a new data type that represents a pointer of the front one. Alright, so then the question is how we can know the memory address of a certain variable. For example, okay, let's think about we declare a int a, then a is a variable. A is also a normal integer variable. Then how do we know that the memory address of a? Because a is going to have its own memory address. Because it has its own room in the memory. Then how do we know? Then we know by accessing by this AND mark. So when you say A, then represent the value of the A. But this AND A is the memory address of this variable or the room number of the A. Okay, so if we declare int a and star PA, asterisk PA, because this is a plot, this is a point of variable. So we can say PA equal to and A. That means PA's value is the point memory address of A or room number of A. That's how it is used. Okay? This is a little bit confusing part, but a pointer variable is also a variable. It's also the variable, right? It's one of the variables, but that variable is for the memory address. It's similar. Because integer is a variable to represent integer values, integers. Similarly, pointer is a variable for the memory address. That means pointer variable also has its own memory address. That means because it should have some space that can store its value. And the value of the memory address of a pointer can be accessed by this asterisk mark. So for example, here we say int A. Let's think of the int A, and we declare in the star asterisk PA, this a pointer. Then we assign pointer PA is equal to and A. That means PA stores the address of the variable A. Okay? Then if we say asterisk PA equal to 3, that means asterisk PA means actual rooms that are represented by PA. Asterisk PA means the memory of which address is represented by PA. Then basically, that is exactly A. Am I right? That is A. Because again, okay, let me do it again. Let's say A. This is the variable, a variable, right? Just a variable. And when you say PA is equal to A, that is PA is the address of A. Right? Then asterisk PA is the variable of which memory address is PA. That is equal to A. So A is a variable. Then if we say, okay, so PA is the memory address of A, then when we say the star PA, it is it represents the variable of which memory address is a PA. That is A, right? So it is equal to A. So star asterisk PA equal to 3 is exactly equal to A is 3. So asterisk PA equal to 3. That means assign 3 to the memory of which address is PA, which is A. So it is equal, this statement is equal to assign 3 to the room or memory of which address is PA. That is A. So it is equal to assign 3 to A. keep balance to A is 3. It is equivalent to the A is 3 basically. Okay, so let's see this example. Okay, let's see this simple example. Okay, here we declare two integer variables, A and B. Okay, A and B. Then we also declare two integer pointer variables, star PA, asterisk PA, and asterisk PB. Okay, you got it? Then, because we assign two variables A and B, so in the system, in the memory, there's the two variables, it reserves two rooms for A and B. Let's consider that, let's assume that A takes room number 1 and B takes room number 2. And A's address is 1 and B's address is 2. Okay, you got it? Then let's think about, we assign A equal to 3. We assign 3 to A. That means we could store this value 3 to the room A. So that means the value, actually stored value is 3 in A. Then let's think about, Okay, so we actually declare the two variables A and B, and A and B has its own room. And we also declare PA and PB, because these pointers are another variable, they should have their own room in this memory. So let's think about PA takes room 100 and PB takes room 101. So the PB pointer variable itself is another, so it's a variable, so it should have their own room. So by declaring those pointer variables, they actually take their own rooms. And let's say PA takes room 100 and PB takes room 101. Okay? So by declaring this four variable, we actually reserve room 102 and 100 and 101. Then by assign A equals 3, so A's value becomes 3. So in the room 1, the value 3 is stored. And here, PA is equal to A's memory address. This end mark represents A's memory address. Then what's the value of PA? In or 1 or Ichi, Nisan. Is it Japanese? Ichi. And in Chinese? What's the one in Chinese? Yong, 중국어로 1이 뭐죠? E. E or San, right? E. E. Okay. Because the A's, what's the in Arab? What's the one in Arab? How do you call it? Why? Why? A little bit difficult. Okay. Anyway, so in the P, so because the PA equal to and A, that means PA's value is the memory address of A. So A's memory address is 1. So in the PA's room, room 100, the value 1 is stored. You got it? Similarly, PB is equal to and B. That means PB. PB's value or room 101, the B's memory address, 2 is stored. Okay, so in room 100, 1, the value is 1, and room 101, the value is 2. Okay, here you got it. Then we gonna printf percent d and the star pa, asterisk pa. Again, what's the asterisk pa means? It is the value or the variable of which memory address is PA. So in the machine, it first see the PA. Okay, what's the value of a PA? PA's value is 1. Then by this star, the machine looking for what is the value in the memory 1. Memory address 1 or room number 1. So because here is 1, it actually go to the room number 1, then read the value of the room 1. That is 3. Then by this printf function, what gonna be printed out? What gonna be printed out? 3. Or E or san. E or san. Or ichi ni san. I don't know. Anyway. So 3 gonna be printed out. Alright? 3 gonna be printed out. So again, so next one. Star PB equal to star PA. That means, okay, so let's do the star PA first. Star PA, again, the value is 3. Right? So this one is 3. We want to assign 3 to the rooms that PB indicate. Not the PB. The room that PB indicate. That means if you look at the PBs, then it has a value 2. And star PB means the room of which address is 2. Then it go to here. Then we assign, we store 3 in this room. Then B's value becomes 3 because B's memory address is 2. So finally, it should have the values. It should have such values in the memory. Okay, so we're gonna repeat it the next session, but let me little bit explain about this example. So any question about the basic concepts of memory and the pointer? Because this is the most important part in the C program. So let me briefly explain about this example. So this is a real example you can do. So you don't have to do in this session, but you're gonna do it the next Monday. Okay, so this is for example, here we declare two variables, A and B. Then here the integer, then also declare two pointer variables, PA and PB. P means a pointer. So then we assign to PA the memory address of A and assign PB to the memory address of B. Then we print F, A, PA, B, PB. So A is, so A's value is represented by percent D, and PA is represent memory address of A. Then we actually use the memory, because the memory address is something the arbitrary number. So we usually use the unsigned, only positive numbers. That's why we use the percent U. Percent U is to print out integer, but it always print out in the non-negative way. It's only print the positive one only. So we use percent U and for B percent D and percent U. So the result is like that, A and B. Because initially nothing is assigned to A. So the value in the A is something like the garbage number, something random or garbage number. So the weird number is printed out. However, in the memory address of PA gonna be something, it also looks very random, but yes, you are right. So it looks like very random, but it's not a garbage number. It's a real one. It's a real address in your machine. Definitely, this value this value is going to be very different with you and your friends. Because, you know, and every time you run this program, this value is going to be different. Because, you know, the memory, so the room, so the, when you visit hotel, so you cannot guarantee that, you know, you're going to already get the same room. Every time you visit hotel, you're going to get the different rooms, right? So it's a similar. So the, every time you execute the program, you're going to reserve a different space of the memory. So that's why this memory address is going to be different. And B is also, you know, the very random value. And here, it's, you know, the memory address of B. But you can recognize that memory address of A and B, they are, you know, very close together, right? They only different, you know, only A. They only different by A. No. Am I right? No. 12. Only different by 12. So they are very close. Because, you know, they tend to, you know, the assign, you know, the next rooms. So if you visit your friends together at a hotel, then probably the hotel manager gonna assign, you know, the two, you know, the next rooms, right? Because they do it just, you know, the one by one. So they are very close. So in this option, you can actually check, you know, what is actually assigned. If you put the A is 3, A value is changing, but memory address is the same. It's the same. So the, if you assign A is equal to B, so B's value is 3 as you expected, but memory address is never changed. So in the same memory address, they actually, you know, put the same values. Okay, so what's the alright, so then similarly, so this one is for the, you know, assign the, you know, the memory address of A for B, so the room, so memory of which address is, you know, the A's memory address, then we assign that address of 4, then by doing that, A's value, if you print out A, A's value get changed for 4, right? Because we assign new value to the memory space of which memory address is equal to memory address of A. That is A. That means memory address of A and its value, so asterisk and this end mark, that's, you know, the little bit, you know, the, how can I say, complementary functions. So this end mark is for the memory address and the star is for the value of that memory address. Okay? You got it? So similarly, if you assign, you know, the star PB equal to the star PA, that means taking the value of the star PB and put that value to the memory of which address is stored in PB. That is B. So that's why this value is comparable. Okay? So this is an example. So we're going to practice this example in the next section. And we have a homework, you know, until this Sunday, so please submit that homework. And I think we're gonna have, you know, another quiz exam, you know, next Thursday. So next Monday we're gonna have, you know, the normal class, and next Thursday we're gonna have a quiz. Okay, quiz is gonna be from, I don't know. So I'll do that. All right. So any question for the pointer? So we're gonna, you know, repeat this explanation. Pointer in the next class. Okay, thank you very much.